Hello and welcome to run number 4 on our channel, where we try to go for the strongest strategies possible. I also try to diversify it, so not always just draft Shyvana, because it's not interesting to watch in my opinion. And let's see how far we can go. If you really want to improve, I should pause between each of my steps, and I will always try to explain why I do that, and you should think about how can I do, what would I have done in this spot, was it better than what Conan Sun does, or was it worse, and why was it better, or why was it worse. And there are always timestamps in the video description, so if you don't want to see the buckets, you don't want to see the drafting part, you only want to see one special game, feel free to just skip ahead to that part. Okay, let's first start out by looking at these three buckets we get offered. First up, we have this Playful Pranks bucket again. I've talked about this plenty of times, and we have already played this Fizz style once. This is the spell build around where you have Nami synergizing with casting spells, and the Bilgewater half, like Abyssal Guard for example, and Shelly, whereas the Bandle City half focuses on generating spells, mostly pranks, but also these Yordle Squire and Contrologist small spells. I basically try to get some synergy going. You have some strong epics in the Avatar of Tides and Curious Shellfolk. Since we've already done a Fizz in the recent back, I don't want to just try it once more though, even though it's probably the strongest pick here. Next up, we have an Ancient Evil Thresh being offered. Ancient Evil is a pretty weird card pool. It's built around Thresh and Anivia. Before it was Anivia, now it was Tryndamere and Maokai, so Maokai and Tryndamere. Tryndamere currently not in expeditions anymore, and this deck now kind of makes a little bit more sense. Excuse me, because we have Thresh and Anivia. Thresh can pull out Anivia, but this card pool is still just a mess. We have a ton of random one drops to maybe try and flip Thresh. We have absolutely god awful cards like Gluttony and Darkwater Scourge. Never play those, and this deck just generally lacks a concrete game plan. It A tries to swarm with one drops, it B also has these random ramp cards and board wipes and removal, and then it has these super late game cards as well. So it's just all over the place. You also see it's 40 cards in these two pools combined, so pretty random card pool. Next up, we have Vulnerable, the one I will actually pick here. I will explain later why, but this is all focused around the vulnerable mechanic, and you basically have all the cards that give vulnerable, but by coincidence these cards are quite good, like Hired Gun, Rockhopper, Merciless Hunter, Bakai Sunspinner. They're just like removal spells and pretty strong. You also have like Hunting Fleet, which is a card I really like a lot. First of all, I like giving my opponent prismatic cards, but also just 6/6 for 4, and you usually can deal with this 2/3 otherwise. If you play like Renekton, it's even an upside because Renekton can hook this 2/3 and level up faster. And there's just basically no bad card in this deck, like Citrus Courier, Vice Fire, below average, but we only have these strong, focused, basically removal-like cards. The main thing that's missing from this card pool is a good finisher. We have Raz and Sheriff Lariat Rose, but then otherwise you just have to push in damage with our vulnerables. But it basically is not enough to just kill your opponent's units over and over. You need to have a concrete game plan, and that's why I like cards like Chum the Warders and Renekton, because the overwhelm damage and Rune Runner they get in is quite strong. Also Miss Fortune, you can pull something into her rain and make in the bullet time and a laugh tap and kill it this way. So quite a strong archetype in my opinion. The main thing it lacks is any late game. So this is the bucket I'm going to pick here as a first pick, vulnerable. Again, this right side is probably stronger because it has two insane units, but I don't want to draft Fizz back to back. And Thresh just starts with a Gluttony, and this is just unplayable, so don't pick that. I don't like Citrus Courier either, but at least it does something. It's a body and it rallies sometimes, and Yibin Wand is just a decent trick. Okay, quite some interesting choices here. We have the Nami with the Playful Pranks. We already looked at this card pool. We have the Challenger Renekton and the Mega Keg Swain. Let's take a quick look at the other two card pools as well. First of all, we have this Challenger, which is in my opinion in the top 5 card pools right now. Especially the Demacia half, but it's basically the Shurima half is basically the same as Vulnerable, having all these vulnerable givers like Exhaust, Bloodthirsty Marauder, like Ruthless Predator, Rockhopper. But the main difference is this lives a Siphoning Strike in this card pool, but it doesn't live in Vulnerable, if I remember correctly. However, the epics are quite bad. You never want Ascendant's Rise or Emperor's Divide in your deck ever. But we might just switch into Demacia and have this strong Charvin 4 and insane curve basically with Cithria, King Charvin, and Screeching Dragon. Basically, no bad card in this card pool. Swiftwing Lancer, Grand Plaza, and even the early game Umbrella Maker and Battlesmith and Old Man with a. Is it even a sword? It's like a stick. Oh, it's like a banner. Okay. And this is just a very strong card pool overall. Last option I just want to showcase is Mega Keg. This is the Gangplank Swain card pool built around the barrels that the powder kegs. So basically you want to buff up your spells, but unfortunately this card pool is awful. You have cards like Blade's Edge, Shakedown. Why is this card here? Do you want to deal 4 to your own ally? Death's Lotus is very hard to use. And it mostly just goes into ignoring these powder keg synergies at all, totally ignoring them, and just playing on curve, playing units, and being an aggressive deck. You have decent late game finishers, but Splane half especially is very small, as you can see, only 29 cards. And we will just see Blade's Edge, which is just a god awful card, over and over again. So I will go with the intended pairing here with the Renekton. I don't think there are enough spells in these vulnerable to make Nami work, and Mono Bilgewater is not that strong. I really like Siphoning Strike as a finisher, just makes your units so big, your champions, and Raid of Judgment is also a fine removal spell. So that's what I'm going to pick up here. So 1 second, I just open up the overlay and we will go into the draft. Okay, you can see it now. And let's type these in. I count the Eben Wand as a strike fight spell, since you actually have to take it the unit down with one of your units. We have 1 3 drop in Misfortune, 1 6 drop in the Citrus Courier, and another strike fight in the Renekton, and a hard removal spell in the Raid of Judgment. So the challenge for us will be to either just immediately switch to Demacia or find something to as a win condition, basically. Because you won't win the game by just killing all of your opponent's units over and over. There are just strategies that are too strong and counteract that too well. We immediately have the chance to switch to Demacia with the Scouted Out bucket. This wouldn't be a terrible choice. And here we just see what these Challenger Vulnerable buckets are all about. Just Exhaust and Ruthless Predator plus random units. So do we want to switch immediately? I think this pack is not too bad for that. Because Demacia is just the strongest region, Shurima, Pilgewater just lack the finishers, the blowout cards to make mono these two regions work. I think I will just immediately go into the 3-color with the Demacia. Normally I don't like 3 colors, but in this archetype it's fine since all 3 work together quite nicely. And just kind of need this Demacia for having decent late game. Here I don't want to move into Demacia and Steel, this is the mono elite bucket, and Vanguard Squire is quite bad. I don't want to be overly aggressive, and I like Siphoning Strike quite a lot. So this is what I'm going to push for here. 2 and 3. Okay, not a big fan of Confront, but these are the buckets I want to have showing up, like Challenger Vulnerable and the Scarlet Out. Confront is one of the only bad cards in the Challenger buckets. And Bone Crusher is still decent, it's still 10 stats for 4 mana. But we might would pick up Edwin anyways. I just want to have this strong 2-drop in the Boxtopus, even without healing. He's a challenger and can pull stuff into Misfortune, and Riposte is just a strong combat trick as well. Like I said, Relative Judgment a good card, but you don't want to just have 1-for-1 trades. You have to actually win the game somehow. Okay, never pick Chrono Shift. I can already say that much. And this card is just way too situational to ever be worth it. Same with Brush Gambler. I like it in some discard strategies where this card doesn't really matter, but if you discard 2 real cards for it, it's just awful. But here we go for the Absolver, another good combat trick with the Rune Runner. This is one of the main ways to close out games with the big overwhelm damage on some small vulnerable unit. So yeah, these other packs are just awful. Let's go for this one. Okay. Next up, Exhaust Rockhover, already amazing. Bio Branch is unplayable, don't put this into your deck, and Vice Fry is hard to use. But I want to have every Rockhopper possible in this style of deck. So let's just go for this one. Fortunately, no Demacia showing up anymore. Don't know what happened. Maybe they just thought I misclicked or something, but I would like some more Demacia to show up. Playful Trickster, not that strong. Like, hard to use, and we don't step to a swarm in a non-lurk deck. I get that you can trigger Misfortune with it, but that's just not something I really want to do. I also don't want to stack up on Citrus Couriers, and Sandswept Tomb gives us some sort of inevitability, even though I don't like the card as much. But Bloodthirsty the Marauder is just a 1-drop as well, so let's go for this side. Finally, a Demacia card showing up again, but not the one we want. Okay, Challenger Bucket it is probably, like Merciless Hunter is just amazing, and Bloodthirsty Marauder, even after the nerf, it's just a 3 mana deal for damage, or just a fearsome unit that allows your Bloodthirsty Marauder to trade into something. Make It Rain is also good, but I don't like War Chefs, it's just so situational and just sometimes dies. And Yibin Wand is just outclassed by Merciless Hunter, and Bloodthirsty Marauder is just stronger and cheaper than the Bone Crusher. So left here for me. More Merciless Hunters. Again, we need some late game, some stuff to do later on. We can't just do like 1-for-1 trades all the time. But unfortunately, we don't get offered any Screeching Dragons, for example. That's the card I moved into Marcia for. Bio Branch is again unplayable, and I just like this Merciless Hunter and Exhaust more than these two. Finally, some Demacia showing up. We have the. One moment. We have the Vanguard Surgeon, which is just an amazing unit. Pairs well with all of our vulnerables, can just value trade, and another back-to-back. It's just our late-game combat trick of choice. Could go for his too, but I don't like these Unraveled Earth that much. Just replaces itself and sometimes just doesn't do anything. And Vanguard Surgeon is just such a powerhouse, way stronger than First Blade. And again, these spells, we have enough of these effects already. And another combat trick. Okay, more Brash Gamblers. I already talked about that I don't want this card, I don't want Bio Branch either. That's why I was a little bit hesitant on moving into the Scouted out. So the Strike Spell plus Rockhopper it is. Finally see our first Honored Lord, unfortunately with another Exhaust, we already have 2 in the deck, and this effect is a little bit redundant, we have no card draw. Quickshot Corsair would be also an option, but I think the Honored Lord is just too strong to pass up here, and it's just better than War Chefs, even though we have so many Exhausts already. Okay, wow, that's a finisher pack. if I've ever seen one. Obviously left this out, we don't want Snapshot Swarm. And we have the Prodigy and Swiftwing Lancer here. Swiftwing Lancer basically a Screeching Dragon, albeit a bit worse. Rockhopper, Charm the Waters, also quite strong. Let's take a quick look at our curve. We have four 2-drops, four 3-drops, but I think these two cards are just stronger if our curve doesn't really need this 2-drop anymore. And as our trade pick, I'm not a big fan of the Green Fang Wardens. It might be decent in this deck, just killing two things. We have a lot of these effects already. This would be just a strict upgrade, like 3-1 into a 3-2. With Hornet Lord is very strong in our deck. And I would like this Radiant Guardian as well, albeit it's hard to activate. So I think it's just middle for me. I can see bottom as well. If you feel like you have too many vulnerable effects, but this is just so strong. Okay, so a weird mid-range deck with no real strong win con other than our champions and siphoning strikes. I will see you in the games. Okay, game number one. We are already against the strongest deck in the meta right now, Malefic Descent with Shyvana. Fortunately, it's game one, so they only have one Shyvana, but let's see if we can still power through. I will not keep Exhaust or Runerunner, but Riposte is a surprise card they might not expect from us, and it can just take down Shyvana for sure. Also keep my 3-drop, because you always want the 3-drop at least. And now we see a little bit of the problem of these interaction spells and this deck in general, where we just have spells but no actual units to play proactively. Our opponent doesn't do anything either. Kinda surprising to me. I will just run out my Bloodthirsty Marauder here. Maybe go for a exhaust play, depending on what he plays. If he just passes, I think he just has nothing. Probably just a bad draw, too many dragons. Unfortunately, we had a bad draw as well and were unable to punish it. Blank Vanguard Redeemer. And three, six, seven. So I'm quite afraid of this deck, this opponent's deck going into the future. Don't think I have enough. I want to spend as much mana as possible here. And I'm going to fall for the Merciless Hunter, not really because I care about this unit, but because I want to play a 4-2 over a 3-1 here. Next turn we will have to play the Sunset Tomb, which is hard to deal with for these Demacian decks. They have to kill all of our units, which is possible for sure. Okay, goes for the self 2-for-1, what? Okay, so I just spent 2 cards just to make this trade work, and I will give up one of my combat tricks to get this unit off the board. That seems like a good trade. That's definitely a card advantage for us. Used 3 cards here, only to kill our 1-drop. Well, that doesn't seem worth it. I will go for the Sandswept Tomb here. Unfortunately, you can't vulnerable hook something with these sand chargers. But so this is has Fearsome, so we don't have to be afraid of this blocking us. And if they want to jump block these chargers, that's fine as well. Okay, it just goes to 8. And these chargers will just keep coming, so they have to do something about them. Not sure what this pass is all about. I will just deploy my units, maybe go for... okay. So a pretty obvious plan here. I will give him another option in the Fleet Feather Tracker and maybe just trade into this Protector if he attacks with it. Not much else to say here. I hope you like this board. I think it's the best feeling. We have the Powder Monkey here to show for Bilge Warder. and we will just deploy our units. Not sure what's going on here, it's just a random dude. This is a good trade for us. And then we can pick this good trade. Fortunately, we have a little bit too many vulnerable effects in our hand. So, I would like to draw one of my mid-game units, like Renekton, Safecracker, Swiftwing Lancer, etc. But as long as we have a Sensor Tomb, they will eventually have to jump block it and will be in trouble from that. Okay. Let's just... Oh, this is a good draw. I will play Misfortune first, because it just kills this Fleet Feather Tracker for free, and yeah, seems like a good trade-off. And I shouldn't be able to play a very scary unit. It's just... I might strike her here. The Screeching Dragon is totally fine. I think I want to cycle out my Yibin Wand here. So I will just go for this and then hook the Fleet Feather Tracker with the Misfortune. Maybe setting up a Riposte here in the future, if he goes for like a single combat here. Still have these 4 mana up. I know that I can just hook this with the Prodigy, but... I can just set up Lethal here as well by, if he has no other units, just the action spells, I can push in Lethal. Here comes the Strike spell or the Fight spell, he just kills it himself. That's fine as well. Let's see if he has another unit, otherwise he's dead on the board, because we can just double hook and have 8 damage here. He has the Aristocrat, but I think he still dies. Because the Riposte allows us to buff up the Sensor and Charger and deal 8 damage. So Riposte can sometimes just be used as a Elixir of Wrath as well. I will let him block first and I don't know, maybe play a spell or something. And then I can still play my Riposte afterwards. Should be anyway, single combat doesn't stop it, any ping doesn't stop it. So that should just be game. Yeah, Sensor Tomb definitely wonders this game in the end. Otherwise we will set around, try to trade one for one with Screeching Dragons, which is just not working out. Okay, pretty fast first win, so we can move on to our first champion pick after you've clicked through all of these post-lobby screens. Hello. Ooh, Cythria of Clouds. Like, I would have just picked any of these champions up at this point, but I will look at these second cards. Hired Gun would also be nice, Greenton Worgen, but main thing we lack is a finisher, and Cythria is for sure a finisher. Chavanfor would probably be the best champion here, but Cataclysm and Lorand Duelist are below average. We don't have any scouts for using it with combos, or most of our units have already Challenger, or we can just vulnerable stuff. So I will just pick up this Cythria here. Let's fix our curve really quickly. We now have 4 drops and 1 8+, and I'll see you in the next game. Okay, next game loaded up. We play against a spell-based strategy, apparently, with Vigar and the Lee Sin. So interaction is key, but we also have to put up some pressure. And this is just the perfect hand for it. Don't want Riposte, but this is just a 2-3-4. Oh, 1-2-3-4, I should say. It really pressures your opponent to have something. And with these Vigar and strategies and Lee Sin, they usually take some time to get going. And they don't even play Shadow Isles, so don't even have many good control tools. This might just be a Bandless Swarm deck, but then these champions don't really make much sense. So I will play this Rockhopper first. Might discourage him from playing a 2-drop if he doesn't want it to just die. And if he doesn't have a 2-drop, it's just 3 more damage. And Sure. I will hook with the rock hopper here because this is a one drop and theoretically it can be a bigger threat for my opponent because of the one drop synergies that Bilgewater has. Okay, I will happily vulnerable you. And this is just pretty good start for me, I would say, because Challenger into the Bandle Commando next turn and Fearsome Unit, which is just pretty strong against Bandle in general. Let's go for the Renekton. Renekton, I don't know. Okay, we can just take this Veigar down next turn, but for now let's just push in this damage. Rush, okay. That's a like kinda 2-for-1, but something I'm fine with basically. Sure, he stacks his darkness a little bit, but that still is not enough to take down my Renekton, and he needs like a group shot or something to make this worth it. So I will hope he just plays some random card and I can just flip my Renekton with Siphoning Strike. Gets a little bit sketchy if he plays darkness on my Renekton as his first play. But this is just a random card, so let's just take out this. Shouldn't be any way to stop this for these two colors. Battle City doesn't have any spells to protect these units, and Ionia only has Rush for one mana. So, yeah. Siphoning Strike is always a skill testing card. Dung. I think there's nothing more satisfying than donging a champion of your opponent. It's just so nice. Next turn we can just play our units out and do a big attack. And they shouldn't have any hard removal. I could have like bounce spells or like a mini morph, that would be annoying. But I just hope they don't have a mini morph, I guess. No attack obviously. And we don't need to open attack either. I will just lead with the Rockhopper to discourage him from playing any more units. If he, my main fear is Minimorph, I shouldn't be afraid of him spending mana now. Because if he spends mana now, he can't play Minimorph anymore. And if he doesn't have Minimorph, he should probably lose anyways. So, no more Minimorph. I will just go for the Prodigy here now. He might go for the Darkness to kill one of my 3-1s. Otherwise he's just dead on board, because I can double challenge and he's a 13 damage. So he goes for that play, which means his Lee Sin now can't get barrier anymore. So I will prioritize taking out his win condition over winning the game on the spot, but I can't win this turn anymore, so I will just do this. And I think this trade-off is also worth the 3 damage getting in. Now they are out of champions, and yeah, I don't really see a way for them to come back here. The rush, okay. Another card down. No, what? Oh, the rush. That makes at least survive. That's crazy. Wow. I still take a lot of damage. Wow. Rush, best card in the game confirmed. Like, that was a sick rush. This Lee Sin is at 3 out of 8, so not close to flipping yet. We just draw a second Renekton, so even if we deal with that, we still probably push in lethal. Hidden Pathways puts Lee Sin up to 4. But I'm hard pressed to see how he will play 4 more spells with 4 more mana this turn. If he gets me the chance by priority passing, I will make this Lee Sin weaker, probably. He could still kill me with a bounce spell or something. I seriously didn't consider this rush. Okay. Give an ally plus 2, give an enemy minus 2. Now his Lee Sin challenge is not that strong anymore. I honestly think we might just lose to the Will of Ionia here at some point, or Homecoming, or whatever, because we are just a little bit slow now. Octopus. That's fine. I will just play my box to push because this is a champion spell, so I probably can't hit it. And surely Sin can take out one of my units here, but they can take out both. Let's just hope they don't also have this homecoming spell here, because that would be seriously annoying. What's that line? Why do you just give that away? Doesn't make any sense. To me, at least. So, it all comes down to if they have the exhaust here or not. We even have the back-to-back. So I'm just going to attack with both. If he has the homecoming, then we lose. If he doesn't have homecoming, then we win. Did he top deck it? Okay, he's looking for it. Does he find the Will of Ionia homecoming or not? He doesn't, so that's the game. So, clutch comeback from our opponent, almost, because this exhaust was actually pretty sick, but this rush was actually pretty sick, but I don't think this combination of champions really makes that much sense. You should have at least moved into Shadow Eyes to have the control tools necessary to deal with stuff like this Renekton. Okay, for our trade pick, let's see what we get offered. I like more hired guns. This is just such basically the best Bilgewater card. I want to keep my Sense Whip Tomb as a win condition. I would be fine trading out the Absolver, but this is just another filler card and I will just take this upgrade here for the hired gun. The best matchup for these decks is like a Teemo, for example, or a deck like Fiora that really relies on the combats to go right, or certain units to stay alive. Even Viga is not that bad of a matchup, because you can just kill the Viga pretty consistently. And so, let's see you in the next game. Okay, next game. It seems like a mirror matchup. Don't know why the enemy is missing, like the enemy picture, but both playing Renekton, and this is just all about this card, basically, Siphoning Strike. That's why I will keep one of them, and I will also keep these Strafing Strikes. Whoever gets a successful Siphoning Strike off wins this matchup. And Strafing Strike is a way to stop a successful Siphoning Strike by maybe just sacrificing our own units. I wouldn't usually keep these two cards, but against this specific matchup it seems worth it. I don't know why I'm timing out as well. Hello? And like, what is going on? Did I just randomly disconnect or something? What is going on here? Okay, like, I mulliganed. It seems like, maybe this is just a visual bug that it shows my time running down instead of my opponent's. I don't know. Let's just focus on the gameplay. Okay, pretty much whole this matchup is only on the board, and health matters. Who wins on the board will be able to use their Siphoning Strikes and their Overwhelm units more effectively. So we will try to get on the board as soon as possible with our two Rock Hoppers, and then try to find some spots for interaction and outplay potential. Or maybe my opponent is just AFK, but he passed turn 1. So I'm really confused what's going on here. Riven has three different card pools. It can be the Spiders Go Wild card pool. Renekton only has these two, the Challenger and the Vulnerable. Riven could also be like the Relic Trackers. It even has four now, right? Augmented Assault or some Augments. It's just like these Blade Fragment build-arounds. Okay. I don't know why you had to rope me for that one, but sure. Could have just passed and then... I don't like people who waste 40 seconds of time just to submit my attack token anyways, so... Why wouldn't you attack? What? I'm confused. I will just play the Honored Lord, he will get me the free trade onto this vulnerable unit, and yeah, maybe stops it with like a saving strike or something, or single combat, that's totally fine. So I don't know why this guy is so slow playing. I will try to just talk through it. This card is okay, but hard to use in this scenario. Let's just do the obvious trades. You get barrier because of our Onslaught Lord's effect, even if you're vulnerable. Challenge the unit, it still counts as a challenge. And this card is kind of surprising to me. It doesn't live in that many card pools. I think it does live in the Augmented Assault. I have time to check because my opponent is just slow playing it so much. And let's see the Legion Rearguard, Legion Saboteur, Legion Drummer. So only in Mega Keg and Scrap Heap, exactly. So we can already assume he's ever either picked up some Scrap Heap cards or some Mega Keg cards. So like a card like Whirling Death is not Whirling Death, the Death Lotus is something you should consider at this point. Of course, the Rock Hopper lives in these typical Renekton pools. And yeah, I don't really know why this guy is just AFKing. You get this free trade-off, maybe he has internet connections. But now I'm a little bit more afraid of these random ping spells or damage spells. Also, Ravenous Flock, a card I normally never play around, cost me a game last night. But now if I see a Legion Grenadier, I'm already thinking about does he have this Ravenous Flock, does he have the Death's Hand, for example. It's also a card that only lives in these Swain archetypes. And, otherwise, because we are not Noxus, we are like Bilgewater Shurima, Bilgewater Demacia, we don't really have these interaction spells. We have Strafing Strikes, but our main interaction comes through these Vulnerables. My plan here is just to play the Rockhopper. Might have a Renekton, then I might, I don't know, 2-for-1 strike him with the Surfing Strike, but it's like a 3-for-1. Don't think that's ever worth it. I will just play Runerunner next turn. Okay, he probably just slow plays again and goes for the Renekton now, but now my Rolling Sands is actually threatening to take out the Renekton next turn with my Rockhopper. This is just such an amazing unit. And he's just like having a good life, a good time. Maybe the opponent passes again, I have nothing else to do, I will just pass and go to my turn and either go for Renekton or Runerunner. I like to get the Runerunner out first because of Space Shield, and the Siphoning Strike is also really valuable. Like, this is why I like Siphoning Strike and Runerunner, and this is why Siphoning Strike is not the same as like a card like Dawn and Shadows, or Dawn and Dusk I think it's called, the two ephemeral units. Because there are actually spatial units in the same region as this card, whereas in Ionia and even Shadow Eyes there are no spatial units, so paying like these big payoff cards is not really that easy. Okay, opponent returned finally. Don't know what is going on over there. Maybe his mom said food is ready and he has to go. And I don't know about this play. This 3 mana for 2 mana and I still have my Whirling Death going on, so I'm totally fine with that. Whirling Death, a card that lives in a lot of card pools. This one damage doesn't really matter. I didn't want to attack with Runerunner, obviously, because I want to have my Siphoning Strike up next turn. And whatever unit he plays will get vulnerable here. But does that work? Yes, sadly. But I can stop this with a Strafing Strike next turn if I have to. Message Hunter, of course, a card that lives in Renekton card pools, so doesn't tell us anything. They find the Glory Seeker, and I am just probably going for this Siphoning Strike here, and can still play the Renekton afterwards. If I just pass, they will just pass back. So, question is, do I Siphoning Strike this or this? And I think I will Siphoning Strike this because the other guy is vulnerable. I'm mainly doing this for the buff and to, because this card is hard to use. If he just gets rid of my Space Shield unit, he might have, I don't know, some other fight cards. And this buff is just so huge on the Renekton. We still take a good unit, it's a little bit expensive, but okay. And they can't really deal with my Renekton anymore. They take up both of my units here, but that's totally fine. Oh, he does it like this. It doesn't really matter because it's just a double trade at this point. Unless he has like an exhaust or something, but what? No! Ruthless Predator. But it's still another card for a card. So I didn't really think of that trade, otherwise I might have kept up the strafing strike. I thought he would just like trade. But it's fine, I have another Renekton in my hand. So yeah, comes down to the Vile Brutal Hunter, also a card that lives in all the Riven card pools, so nothing new here. And they should have a hard time dealing with Renekton. Of course, if they are a Mega Cake or an Arachnophilia, they have access to Noxian Guruity and Scrap Heap, so that's kind of a card to worry about. But it's really hard to play around it. Yeah, Savage Reckoner coming in. And I think I will just go for an Exhaust play here. Yes, finally getting this card out of my system. And yeah, that just seems fine. Yeah, pretty close to Renekton level up. We have a health advantage. And true opponent has this guy, but we have champions for days. We can even back to back. She just hooks my Renekton over going for the damage. We have this guy. If he doesn't open, he just loses his. Like, Shurima is very good against followers. Value judgment is amazing against these high cost followers. But Shurima's main weakness is to deal with champions. And I don't want to play my Misfortune here because he will just attack. And after he attacks, I'm fine with. What is this attack? A Might, maybe. I will take the bait if he allows it. Maybe another Whirling Death, but I can counter Whirling Death pretty easily with the Strafing Strike. Another Whirling Death, so we just take out this guy. Just do it like this as well. No, but it doesn't have Fury, right? But it flips. Doesn't have Fury, but it flips. So that would leave him at. Would save my other unit. And he flips plus one with him like a guy. I think that's actually fine. Yes. Because like this he flips and then he still loses. He just has one real card and one Blade Fragment. This last one real card is a execute like the Noxian Guillotine or the card like, what's the other one called? Scorched Earth. It's fine. Because then he has no cards at all. I also will develop my Misfortune because this Rolling Sands doesn't matter at all, and I want to get the open attack in. And that's just game, because open attacking means this guy doesn't die to a Blade's Edge, Death's Hand, etc. anymore. Okay, a little bit of a slow play in the beginning, I hope I made it interesting still. Let's go ahead and see what our trade picks are here. That's trade picks, it's my champion pick. Again, I like Charmin the Fourth pretty much as a one-off in this type of deck. We still need a little bit more late game. Misfortune, like all these cards are decent. Sandspin is decent. Galen Rider would be quite strong with all our vulnerables. Riposte is a decent trick. Razorhearts Garante is a quite a strong card with just scout and attacking multiple times. Bakai is strong. We will trade one for one and then we have a 2-for-1 in the Bakai. And Siphoning Strike, obviously one of my favorite cards in this archetype. And from the champions, I think that Charvin is just the best out of these. Yeah, we have two Renektons, Misfortune. We have enough early game basically, and I want to have these more late game options. Okay, so we have our final deck. I'll see you in the next. Okay, up against Nami Victor. Very interesting combination. Because I can see where they're coming from. By like Victor generating all these spells, these small units generating these spells, and then Nami having being in the payoff. But we should be able to deal with Nami quite well. I'm not going to keep Bakai, he's not usually active at turn 5. I'm not going to keep Saving Strike or Riposte either. I just want to have more proactive units, because this Nami decks will mostly just pass the first few turns to get Nami level up. Don't expect a 1 drop here. I don't even expect a 2 drop here. Maybe the. How's it called? The Scrap Scratch? No. The Humanity is obsolete. Why wouldn't you play that right away? That was a good play by my opponent. Like, I don't blame them. Because Rockhopper is the most common card, but what if I just don't have a 2-drop? Then you don't get anything in. And I will definitely let this hang around for my Renekton. to eat later on. Okay, let's just play the stronger unit. They have a random one cost and probably don't want to play anything into my challenger units here, or my challenger unit. But if they just pass, they lose all this mana, and obviously they don't want to kill this guy. If he just passes, I pass back. Okay, that's annoying. So, Nami at 3 out of 8. I definitely want this trade to happen, 3-1 versus 4-3. I don't want this 1-2 to trade, and I don't want to take out this 1-2 because it's a liability against Renekton, basically. So that's why I'm not attacking here, despite being like an aggressive deck. I don't think this is really a like a control deck per se. It's all coming down to these siphoning strikes and interaction. Tidal Wave, okay, didn't expect that card, I don't really like it. But it's fine, I just take up my Rockhopper. And I'm a little bit afraid of any vulnerable spells here myself. So I might just pass here, or I will just play Renekton anyways. If he plays an Exhaust, he doesn't have Exhaust. If he plays a Chum the Waters, that would be bad, but I don't. Chum the Waters doesn't live in Nami, so I'm not playing around it here. I just want to play an active card. Oh, the Hanyu been warned. Like, this card pool of the Wondrous cost regions is so bad. So you usually don't see the Yi been warned. There's like 6 different ones or 8 different ones. What I can do here is now I play Exhaust. Now I can't kill my Renekton, hopefully. Unless he has a buff spell or a Mystic Shot or something. So he thinks, seems like he has a Mystic Shot, but then it's... What? No way, sure. Good exchange, but like, I should have played around this card, obviously. It only lives in one of the victor pools in the augmented assault. But it's okay. Definitely didn't see that coming. But I'm just going to play my Sandsweb Tomb now and put up pressure this way. But this generation of the one drop Ebion Wand has been pretty lucky for them. Nami is still at 3, Victor at 1. Okay, he has the gotcha to shut down my attack here. It's a little bit unfortunate. But, yeah. He actually might lose this game now, because we don't have any units anymore and they just like kind of outvalued us a lot. But I'm still confident. So I will just play my Boxtopus here. Still have this Riposte up. In comes the Nami at 5 out of 8. I will make her vulnerable right away, try and stop her and shut her down. Tidal Wave number 2. I guess that's fine. And yeah, I will just go for the open attack next turn to make sure this Nami doesn't do stuff immediately. Good thing she was nerfed, otherwise we would have a problem now. Gotcha, I definitely have to prevent that. I have to kill this Nami, otherwise the game is just lost. This is the wrong card? No. Set to spell mana. Okay. And we have to hope this unit survives somehow and we get these siphoning strikes off. Like I thought this Renekton was safe. Another coral creatures. A Nami flip. That's why we had to activate it immediately, because they can flip with an attune unit. If they have a second Nami, I will just concede here. Or I will try to Stifling Strike, but then it's basically lost already. Honored Lord seems fine. Sepp's Brayfin probably throws him. Yeah, pretty good deck here for my opponent. I don't really like this archetype, but they didn't play any bad cards so far. And I will just play my Honored Lord out here. We will get wrecked by this second wave they have, maybe. Insightful Investigator is now good enough for me to... Don't think it really matters which one I strike with. Is there one damage spell in any... Like, make it rain matters, so I will go like this. I just try to get some value out of my Siphoning Strikes here. They have two spells in their hand, one is a 1 cost, one is a 3 minus cost. And so one small spell, one 3 minus spell and two real cards. And of course they have the ball advantage, but maybe we can force them to block at some point with the Sandswept Tomb. Shakedown is the graded one. And Deathray, his own unit, good thing we played around that. That's a real card as well. And Shine. So they will take out my units here, which is of course unfortunate. But we will just kind of in a top deck war where they have two cards ahead of us. But they will draw a Deathray at some point. Nothing we can do here. And I will hold on to my Veil of Judgment for one turn, because I want to see what they draw first. They might have just a very strong card here at some point. So this Ray, Deathray could have actually been, can just draw the second Deathray right away. Pretty good top deck from this situation. And I unfortunately have to use this Veil of Judgment on this not so strong unit. Still a 1-for-1 trade. It's still up 2 cards. It's all coming down to top decks. That's a pretty good top deck. I think that we'll just actually play Charmin here. As stupid as it sounds, but we have no way to spend our mana here. And Pilfered Goods, of course, a good top deck for them. And I have to deal with this Elusive at some point, so I will just do it now, while my Charmin still has Barrier. They have 2 cards from our deck, which are still 2 cards, but might not be something they can use efficiently. I played the Charmin there because I'm not sure I will draw another unit next turn, so okay, just does nothing. I will definitely take this attack. Not sure why they just do nothing. Any Elusive kills me, I'm basically losing. And my main chance to win is by him not then making mistakes. Yibenwand, okay. How does he kill it? Double spell or something. That's the Deathray, okay. They are very fast at redrawing the Deathrays. Unfortunately, like... And a card from my deck. What? Okay. Okay. Just all the spells apparently, and there's the Crashing Wave number 2. I get the draw card from the Yibenwand. And what was the generated card, like the Yibenwand or what? Okay, Cythria is definitely a card. I have to play her unfortunately because and they have 2 cards here. An Elusive would still kill me probably. And what is this? Pilfered Goods. Okay. Just for 1. And Vanguard Sergeant. Okay. That's a pretty good draw for my deck, I'd say. If they attack, they just die. Merciless Hunter also decent. Make this stronger one vulnerable. And they have to have another unit to match this. This doesn't work because our Sandstone Charger will kill them. So they have to either play a unit or play this Crashing Wave they have, exactly. So now I want to prevent damage on my Cythria as much as possible, so I will hook this unit and force them to block with the other one. And this top deck war continues. What a battle. Like, I obviously can still lose, but with the Scythia on the board, nice Runerunner now. Like, any Elusive plus the for the Master probably kills us now. But at this point, basically everybody deserves to win by just fighting on that long. I'm not mad if I lose this game at this point. 11 minutes into a game, it's fine. Looking at our opponent's deck, they had a Victor. It's a flip Victor. So it would be kind of sad to see the flip Victor just closing out this game. But we'll just play my Runner now because it doesn't matter anymore. Then I can pass. And he gets the Victor flip. If he gets elusive, he wins. If he doesn't, like he doesn't straight up win. I still don't know what this other card is in his hand. And let's watch this animation. I think Victor is a decent card if the game goes long. But in general, mid-range threats are not the strongest here. He hits elusive, you have to exhaust. Okay, quick attack. Not that bad. I'm still threatening the Scythia block, so I will just pass for now. And I will block. I will block. Because if his last card is just a burn spell or something. The Absolver! Okay, that doesn't kill us though. Oh, that was it still my card? What? But this doesn't get overwhelmed on this. There's the second half. Oh, close, but not quite there yet. Oh, created cards cost one less. What? What an awesome ending. That's 13. That's 11. That's exactly 6 still. Oh, created cards cost one less. Insane. You couldn't have described this scenario if you would have told me what two cards kill me here. And I kind of misread the situation. All I can do is exhaust here. And yeah, they still exactly kill me. Well played. I'm not even mad I lost. This was a great game. And I will give them satisfaction of killing me exactly. Well played. Yeah. Top deck wars. They can come down to both sides. I think they are favored in the top deck war. Because they are just... They were ahead a lot. But they also had a lot of bad cards shuffled into their decks, so it could have gone both sides, but I'm happy about this game. It was just a lot of fun to play. Okay, I will still hold on to the Sandra Tomb, seems amazing still. We don't have that many synergies with the Desert Naturalist, but I will get rid of the Strafing Strike for a rally effect here. Even though it's one of our few fast speed interaction spells, I still think rallying is more important to being more proactive in this deck. See you in the next game. Okay. Next game coming up. Against another Fizz Nami deck. This should be a pretty good matchup for us, because we can kill their engines pretty reliably with all these exhausts. I will still look for more early game though. Because we need early game, otherwise we can't challenge anything. Fortunately, we draw awfully. Like we have a decent amount of late game in this deck, but just don't draw any. We have a good curve, and we just draw more 5-drops, which is obviously not what we want. If we don't draw a 3-drop, I'm calling bullshit. What is this attack? Why can't I pass with my spacebar? So we have not many unplayable cards left in our deck. Okay, saved. Okay, I will just try to kill it now. So the Nami definitely the biggest champion threat. They have two Fizz and one Caitlyn. And getting rid of this Nami is definitely good here. So it's one of my bigger problems than. We have, because we had such a bad start, we have a lot of late game cards and mid game cards. Okay, Marai can of course screw us over, so we will try to end the game as fast as possible. But generally, I don't really like this random effect. Charwin the Fourth coming out, I will just lead with a Rune Runner here. And I can then set in an exhaust play on this guy. They get a fleeting copy of a spell in their deck. Let's hope it's not one of these guys, of the 6 cost ones. Okay. Don't know what this surrender is all about, but I take it. Not 0 wins. Great. Would have been probably interesting. But I guess they just surrendered. Okay, this is a great trade. Genevieve for a back-to-back. I don't really like these other two cards. They're not that great of upgrades. Generally like having one back-to-back, but two is a little bit too much, and Genevieve is just an amazing card. So... 3 and 6. I'll see you in the next game. Okay, next game coming up. We are against the raiding party, most likely the archetype. Pretty high mastery opponent. They might just play the deck in Constructed. I doubt they played it that much in Expeditions. The big strength of these raiding party decks is their champions, basically. They're all focused around getting these champion pickups. And that's why I'm willing to keep Charvin the fourth, actually, because he will allow us to deal with one of these champions for free, basically. Not being as greedy and keeping Siphoning Strike, but Charvin the fourth is just such a strong answer to their stuff. They might just rush us down somehow, but I doubt it. Warning shot. Okay. First uptick, you always have to keep track of how many upticks they have and deny them as much as possible. They get one card from my deck. Don't know for sure how they... The cards from my deck are all decent, but nothing amazing. I'm not afraid of anything. Longor, Prodigy, or the... What? Okay, it's just... The game was refreshing. I kind of try to level up Miss Fortune if it's possible. So that's why I'm playing her first. They might not have a good unit here to block into my misfortune. And I don't expect her to survive too long against this matchup. And I'm not doing this trade. I could have exhausted, but I want to keep exhaust for Renekton. No? Yes. Nice. So now we know the top of their deck is a Freljord card. They shouldn't have any way to interact with this. There is no +1/+0 in these colors or regions. And this one will be an interesting turn. We have double exhaust plus rally. So I don't want to run just this 6-3 out into these 3 costs or 3 health units. We will just lead with the prodigy. Maybe we will just tap out for anything. This leftmost card is a Freljord card. We know that because it missed the allegiance. And I think this card, no, this card, one of these two is one of the cards of my deck. They don't play anything at all, which makes this quite interesting. What I think I'll do is, they might have a Harsh Winds or something, which would be annoying. Which one is more important to kill? Doesn't matter, both are 3-3s. And... I will go for the exhaust here. And also attack with... Do I attack with Miss Fortune? Yes, because I don't really care about her dying. They might have a Fury of the North here and take this down. They might have multiple small combat tricks. We still have the Ruthless Predator to interact with it. Let's see what they have. Elixir of Iron is totally fine. This just makes the unit survive. But doesn't stop us at all. And in comes probably the game plank. And this is makes Charvin flipped already. Which is pretty bad for them. So that was not the leftmost card. We still know this leftmost card is a Freljord card. Unless I miscounted. And I'm just going to flip this right now. There's no need to raid around. Just put up the pressure where you can. Take out this guy, he protected for whatever reason. Okay, powder keg. Means he shoots down my misfortune probably. But that's still a card for a card, and my Renekton flips. And yeah, I will keep take this trade and take this flip. So they should still, unless I missed something, they should still have a card from my deck. Because I don't run Bull Sharks. I don't run any cards he has right played so far in my deck. So this one card from me, one Freljord card, and now a Fleeting card. This turn is a little bit scary because of Sejuani. Exactly. But what we can do is actually exhaust Sejuani and prevent our Renekton from getting killed here, and then just go for the Rune Runner. That will probably still damage my Renekton, which is fine. But next turn my Charvan comes out. I think that was his Freljord card. But these are not really that scary if you don't let them level up. And here comes the attack with the Charvan. It's just so much tempo, so much initiative. And we fight again! Woo! Love Charvan's animation. It's so awesome. No quarter. And just concedes off of that attack. So yeah, this is why the Challenger archetype is in my opinion one of the strongest archetypes. We didn't really face the real decks yet, like Malefic Descent or Darkness. But against a general deck, this Challenger archetype is just so strong. I can't hold any units on the board, and once you get your champions, your payoff cards, it's really insane. They still don't like us having this Sensei Tomb, apparently, but I'm still going to hold on to it. And do I really need it? Helps us against these full control matchups where we just throw a unit at them, but at this point they just kill all of our unit anyways. I think this Hornet Lord is better. Let's bring up our curve quickly and tap, remove this 5 and add it to our 2 drops. Okay. Again, skipping ahead till we. Okay, next game coming up against Set Katarina with Demacia. It's pretty interesting. As an archetype to face, we have the Katarina, which only lives in Relentless, which is a mid-range style of deck, and the Set, which lives in Discipline and Shadows and Dust, but mostly it's just a build-around champion. I will keep the Honored Lord and not the Riposte. I'm hoping to find a vulnerable card to pair with him to be able to take out this Set. I'm willing to take 6 damage here early on, even let the Set flip, as long as I don't fall behind too far. With this one I could play either Boxtopus on Honored Lord or the Tracker, but I'm liking this Honored Lord more. The Boxtopus is better in the late game, and I don't want to show this Fleet Feather Tracker just yet. Would have been fine trading into this, but I wouldn't have known that he will play that, because if he has Demacia and Noxus, I assume he would be more of a mid-range deck with the Demacia Noxus, but it seems like he's more of a Set builder route. Here comes the Set, and we can take him out the next turn. And I will actually just let this Set flip here. You will see why. Because I have the Boxtopus next turn, plus this Siphoning Strike, and I don't like sacrificing a random unit here. We go down to 10, but I should get the board for that next turn. And this is, I think, why I've had such a high win rate, because people are so afraid of him flipping. Now we have 2 very threatening attacks here, and you can also Siphoning Strike if something goes wrong, if they are able to stop that. Sure, we lost a lot of health, but we transferred our health into the board and are now able to take down the Set. If they just play another Set, we have the Siphoning Strike, and that's basically all we have to worry about now. And we are a pretty aggressive deck ourselves, so we can put up counter pressure. Wow! This card is no buckets at all, so I'm surprised to see it in the game. I will just run up my Renekton here, it's just a stronger unit, and this effect would just be wasted. So what does it do? When you summon an ally, give me +2/+0 this round. Seems like a decent unit. We see a Greenglade Duo, I'm just fine. Siphoning, striking this. You could still have a homecoming Will of Ionia though. So I could also wait, but I can't really play any card to wait here. And I could like play the Safecracker or the Rune Runner and just trade into that. That would also be a fine line. I'm a little bit afraid of a set here. I will just pass for now. If he just passes his attack and comes to me, that's fine too. So now he can't play his set anymore. And I will prevent the most damage of this Coastal Defender by playing out the Rune Runner here. It's starting to get scary. He seems to be very aggressive now. And we can Jarvan next turn. Okay, all the 1 drops. We'll take 5 damage here once more, but he should be running out of cards eventually. And again, we can deal with these smaller units at some point. With these elusives. Now in this turn we can just play out this Jarvan, but we might die to some more Greenglade duos. Let me check this really quick. It will hook the Greenglade duo and kill it if I attack like this. Obviously not like this, but I'm still a little bit afraid of set. I think if they had another set they would have played it last turn, so they would have had to be the top deck card. So I think it's decent to get our Jarvan attack in here. We have to put up treasure, otherwise some random elusives will just kill us, and we have the Veil of Judgment. So he has this turn to set up a kill with elusives. If he has it, he has it. If he doesn't, we win. And we could have passed and open attacked and stuff, but okay. So that's 3 elusive damage. If he has 1 more elusive unit, we lose. Or just that. Now we can't have to just draw something. It's unfortunate. You have to ask yourself, would we have really won that game if we had thrown away our Ornate Lord for 4 damage here? We still have these elusives to deal with. Oh, he didn't play it. What? Why didn't he play it? Doesn't make any sense. Okay. Now I can just kill it. Why didn't he play it? Like, he had to play an open attack. Now he might even lose. Crazy. So they can rally here with the second one and they can ping something. We have to keep that in mind, and I want to go double 4 here, the 4 and the 4. So let's start by getting this big elusive threat out of the way and hopefully surviving this turn. Why wouldn't you just open attack and then play Katarina and ping me? I have no access to healing in my regions. That's definitely a misplay on my opponent. I don't know their whole hand, but it just seems like an obvious misplay. Okay, the Fae Guide coming in means he can't replay Katarina anymore, and I will just use this opportunity to... I don't think this ally buff matters, we'll just give it to this guy, and just take 1 damage here, maybe 2 with the Blade's Edge, but hopefully being able to close out this game next turn. I have to block this Katarina here unfortunately, and I will give away my Safecracker here if they want to Blade's Edge it, that's fine with me. That's 1 less damage I take to my Nexus. Yeah, that's fine. This might hurt. So right there, he prioritized the board over killing my units, over killing me, which seems wrong in his spot since he's so far behind already on the board. Now I want to get this Siphoning Strike used on this elusive this turn. He will probably try to rally with Katarina. So let's start with the Prodigy. And then we can, after he plays Katarina, go for the Siphoning Strike. I don't think it really matters which one we strike with. So I will go for... They could have a... how is it called? That's 4, and it still doesn't flip, so I will play around the Sharpened Resolve here. And just strike with this card. If he has a bounce spell, that's unfortunate. But I think that's the line we have to go for. If it just works out, we might have lethal this turn, depending on if he attacks with Katarina or not. So this is a random card, this is a card they held in the since the beginning, and they didn't do it before, so I will have to jump block this Katarina, unfortunately, and then I don't. Sonic Wave, interesting. This will take down my Charvan, I guess, or Renekton. Renekton. Okay. So what we can do here is we trade away this guy, so he has to take 6 damage and like he blocks this thing and go to 1. And my Renekton also flips. Unfortunately, we didn't draw any real cards afterwards. Just drew some 2 drops. And might still lose to this Katarina attacks. But we have some things to jump block here. Let's see, we have also these 100 lords. If our Renekton stays around, they have a Blade Fragment in hand. So that isn't really scary. We might even if we lose this Renekton, it's fine. But they will not have any way to stop this overwhelm damage unless they top deck a homecoming. Shadow Apprentice is from the Shadows and Dust card pool, so I assume this set is not a discipline set, but a Shadows and Dust set. Same with this Fey Guide. Okay. This is a little bit annoying because he can like hook this and get in 1 damage and then hook this again. I will just sacrifice my 100 lords, they don't matter anymore. The only important thing is to survive this turn. This is my main focus. Because if I survive, this Renekton just wins the game for me on my own. So they have 1 real card, it's just top decked, and 1 blade fragment. It's probably the +2/+0, now that would kill me. So it has to be first strike, because any other one he would have used already to kill me. Overwhelm kills me with this, and so who do you hook? We block the other one. And I will just try to take as little damage as possible on my Renekton, if it ever matters. And again, if they just have like a buff spell or something, they just have 1 real card. Here's the fragment. It's quick attack, so that doesn't matter. And I will block this and this. And yeah, if it's a rush, now we don't die yet. But they need a good top deck here. And to stop this overwhelm attack from coming in. Okay, let's see what they top deck, what we top deck. Yibin Wand, it's not worth playing in my opinion. I will just go for this attack and they have to show me that they top deck a answer. It could be like a Loxus card, like a Scrapshot, or just don't have an answer. So yeah, if he came down to the wire, but I think I played that pretty well, and it showcases how to play around set. Once they were able to shut it down, then they don't really have that much pressure, and of course it was very close to in the end, but it's always with such a strong champion as set, and like multiple attacks and elusives. But if we didn't put up counter pressure, we wouldn't have won this game, they would have just overwhelmed us with Katarina attacks over and over. Okay, going into the final pick, or the final match, let's take a quick look at our deck again. We still have 3 exhausts, they're a little bit meh. I would have preferred like 2, because we have so many vulnerable effects anyways. I'd like to trade one of these away. We have a 1 drop, this is good. We have very good 2 drops, 7 of them. And a combat trick, we have the Prodigy. And Merciless Hunters, very strong 3 drops. So basically no bad cards. Remember back in the draft I said in these challenger vulnerable archetypes there's just no bad cards. And that's why we in our deck have no bad cards, just decent, good removal spell like cards, and most importantly the 3 siphoning strikes. I would still like to get rid of Citrus Courier, and we still have this amazing epic late game here. So first pick, Golden Aegis. I want to keep my run rally effect, even though the Penitent Squire would be quite strong. This is a unique effect in our deck and can be powerful with our Challenger units or Renekton just closing out these games. And fine trading out this Citrus Courier. It's hard to use. I never drew it, but I'm happy I never drew it. And I don't want double trouble because it's just too random. So that puts us at 8 2 drops, which is a good number for an aggressive deck. And let's see what the next packs hold. So here we have a chance to trade away these exhausts, one of them. We also could trade away this Veil of Judgment, but I like having a few of them, like at least one. It's just such a decent answer to creatures. Always goes one for one, most like basically kills any follower. Exhaust for War Chefs is interesting, but I don't really like these War Chefs. I think I would rather hold on to these exhausts for the Renekton, and if this was an Honored Lord, a better unit, I would maybe take it. And I really like Hunting Fleet, this is one of the strongest cards, but so is Vanguard Sergeant, so this is another skip for me. Misfortune for Viora doesn't really make sense in our deck. We are built around Vulnerables and Challengers and have no way of protecting Viora. Rune Runner is a pretty good card, Lone Duelist is not. Most of the units have challenge anyways, or the opponents are vulnerable, so we don't need this duelist in our deck. Back to back is a decent one-off combat trick, and it's hard for us to activate Radiant Guardian in this deck since we might have our units die a lot. But just again, we want to be more aggressive, proactive instead of this reactive life gain card. So another skip here for me. I am not a big fan of Veiler, unless you have combos with him. He's just like a Fleet Feather Tracker with Scout basically, and doesn't really do much more that warrants this one extra mana. I still want to hold on to his Golden Aegis, and Fleet Feather Tracker is again good. I don't want two back-to-backs most of the times, unless I'm a really mid-range deck that can go to turns 7, 8, 9 reliably. The Absolver seems also nice with cards like Jarvan and multiple attacks, and it's just like one of our only real combat tricks and just a surprising card. Even though we lost the game against our own Absolver, we have enough 2-drops. Okay, Bakai for Masses Hunter, this one comes down to the curve basically. We have in the second pack Rockhopper for our Sandspinner, is another curve question. Honored Lord for Unworld Earth, it would be just a downgrade because Honored Lord is just such a great card in our deck. If you look at our curve, we only have one 5-drop and three 4-drops already. And I like having 2-drops over 4-drops in general. And this Rockhopper is just stronger than the Sandspinner in most cases. So this is another skip I could see doing this middle trade, but Rockhopper is just so essential for our strategy. And Yeven Wand for Rockhopper. I am not sure about this Yeven Wand. I think this is just a redundant effect in our deck. I don't like Rite of Dominance ever, and I want to hold on to this last Veil of Judgment. So, isn't Rockhopper just a better Yeven Wand in most cases? I think so. We have enough exhausts and other ways to give vulnerable, so that this card is just not that useful, and I would rather have a fourth Rockhopper. So, this is the final deck, and I'll see you. Let me change this overlay quickly. Number 9. So, and this goes for the strike fight cards a little bit lower. So, again, this is the final deck, and I'll see you in the final battle. Okay, it loaded right away, and we are playing against a what I would call very good matchup with two engine cards that want to stick on the board. We are able to pick them off usually with our this curve basically, and they usually have low interaction, but I still don't want the Siphoning Strike. I want to have a better curve first. They are probably looking for their engines. So what I mean with engines is that Zoe and Heimerdinger want to stick around on the board and want to generate value over time, and we're able to deal with that pretty easily while maintaining a board advantage. We see no Zoe here, so it might just be three Heimers, and yeah, let's just, I will actually go down the Honored Lord first, and then we can use this Merciless Hunter and kill this for free. And we could just play Misfortune as well. It seems better because Misfortune starts leveling up and we can hold on to this vulnerable effect. And of course, we still threaten to kill this ballistic bot with our Fleet Feather Tracker with the Misfortune attack. The top deck is a Hush. Okay. If they use their whole turn on playing a Hush, that's fine with me. I Remnov that still counts for the level up, but I will certainly offer this trade. Don't want to throw away my Fleet Feather Tracker here. And they just trade away there. 2-drop while investing my mana into it. And let's see if this counted. No. Interesting synergy here. So Hush means they picked up some Mending Touch. I will probably try to play around that a little bit. Means like I'm more likely to have like an Astro Protection or something like that. Here this one just still dies to the Fleet Feather Tracker, so I will just deploy my Vanguard Sergeant. And now the next turn is very tricky for me, because on the one hand I want to attack, and on the other hand I see that my opponent can have a Heimerdinger still lying around. So I will lead with the Honored Lord, and this will make it awkward for them to either not develop at all or to keep passing until they have to take a lot of damage to, or they just play a unit like that. Not really seeing what this card does here. They probably have like a spell, otherwise it would just be a very bad play because it would just die to Misfortune. So as a 2-cost spell, I mostly think about the +2 health from Targon and Mystic Shot. But I don't really care about this still. I will play my Hired Gun since they don't have enough mana to play Heimer anymore. And now I can just force these strong trades. First of all, this challenge attack, and then just pull this into the fray for free. Probably will just get answered by... Actually, I will do that differently. I will... That doesn't work. Okay. I wanted to hook this with the assembly bot, because I wanted to kill the assembly bot over the... but this one was randomly given. If I would have used the message hunter onto the assembly bot, I would have killed it for sure, but now they can... Oh, they don't even save it. Interesting. So they still lose their whole board and take infinite amounts of damage. So far, pretty weak starting point for this kind of deck. They of course get a random epic now, but most epics in Targon and PNC are quite bad. So I'm not too afraid of that coming up. And we have the 4 Demacia in our hand, we have a Jarvan in our hand, so this next attack should most likely just close it out. They get rid of this epic, it's a Destiny's Call, like I said, a pretty bad card. And I will just deploy my Boxtopus here. Flash of Brilliance, it will give them a card they can't play anymore. And Healing Touch, like they just spend all their mana on non-board stuff and we just generated a big lead through that. And I will just Veil of Judgment here to play around like a... how's it called? Judgment. We just open attack with Jarvan, they might just block Jarvan and Judgment us, but by shooting it down first, we actually prevent the Judgment from, like, they don't have Judgment in the deck, but they just played a Flash of Brilliance. So if the Flash of Brilliance gave them Judgment, they would have access to 8 mana next turn and would be able to block Jarvan that comes in, or just be challenged by Jarvan and then Judgment our board away. And I just played around that by killing that first. Okay, nice little 7 win run, pretty quick, and I'll see you in the analysis. Okay, so let's head over to Elara Guardian and take a look at our deck. I'm not really sure what happened in here, because it doesn't show up yet. I had recorded another run with Ferrero and Ash before for this draft number 4. Unfortunately, it my audio bugged and I couldn't upload it. It was an interesting tempo deck, but we just ran into some bad matchups. And it wasn't that interesting, so I didn't want to upload it without sound. As you might see, I have been tryharding a little bit and going for 7 wins a lot more lately instead of just going for fun decks when I play on my own, because I want to know what I'm talking about, give you suggestions. Let's look at our deck though. I didn't have Elara Guardian up for... it seems like it didn't work for the second to last game, but you can still take a look at these decks. In our first round, we played against this Demacia midrange deck with Shaman and Thresh. and it's just a bunch of random units and a bunch of random spells. And I remember this Redeemer play with the Ranger's Resolve and the Confront. They have triple Confront in their deck, which is obviously a mistake. And we just were able to overpower them quite nicely. Against the second guy with the Darkness deck, this is quite an interesting archetype, Darkness plus Lee Sin, with the Oedipus and random spell generators from Bandle and Lee Sin. Unfortunately, seemed like too much of a meme, which has just so many bad cards, Furious Fairfolk, Emerald Awakener, Hidden Pathways, and yeah, it just didn't work out for them. We were able to just kill the engines and barely win. In the next game against this mid-range mirror, they were actually way more aggressive. As you can see, they had almost no late game, lots of 2-drops, and we're actually missing a 5-off. Again, if you look up here, it should be 36 cards or 34 cards, and it doesn't show up. No, it's still 33 because like they only have 3 champions. That makes sense. Of course, some bad cards in here as well, like Blade's Edge, but clearly a very aggressive deck, and by manipulating the draws and having a bit more late game, we managed to beat out this aggressive mid-range deck as well. Then we lost to this Victor Zoe deck, Victor Nami deck. Interesting deck when I look at it, has a lot of removal spells like Gotcha and Naked Rain, the Ebb, and then just a good curve overall. One Puffcap Peddler, one Joining Sandhopper, and yeah, 3 Tidal Wave, which is surprising to me, but makes sense if the game wants to go long. One Marai Great Mother, and we kind of got screwed by, I don't even remember what the play was, our, I think our Siphoning Strike got cancelled by the Death Ray, and then we just fell behind too far on the board somehow. But yeah, seems like a very good deck, very well constructed deck, and I'm fine losing to such a strong deck and happy that Nami makes an appearance in Expeditions. Then we were up against this other Bilgewater deck, which seemed way more random. If you look at it now, just had a ton of random cards: Poro Cannon, Warning Shot, Advanced Intel, Picker Card, Trail of Evidence, all of these cards, Tidal Wave, you don't want in your deck. And it seemed to be built around my Great Mother a little bit, and around these Tidal Waves, but most of all it just seems like a random pile of cards with a decent curve in the front. So not sure, probably this is all-in spell, but why is the Caitlyn then? And I just don't like these spells, it just seems like a very high-rolly, low-rolly strategy and not something very consistent. So, and afterwards we faced against Gangplank Sejuani, I think it was a 2-2 split, yes. And as we can see, they didn't have the most aggressive deck ever, but decent mid to late game, Erosion Hardguard, Skymaiden Reaver, Wildclaw, etc. And this is why I value Jarvan that highly, because they can have, they actually have Maggot Rain and Ice Shard to stop it, but they would still lose their Gangplank and Sejuani. They don't really have much to close out games with other than like an Alpha Wildclaw or ICAD, because most of the deck is built around these stacks of Gangplank and Sejuani. So if you shut down the engines, this deck just falls apart. Unfortunately, our former opponent, like this one before that, didn't show up. And we can take a look at this engine deck. It's a triple Heimerdinger deck. Kudos for getting that far with triple Heimerdinger and especially triple Guiding Touch. Very surprising to me that they didn't get overrun by other decks before. They only have like Gotcha and one Aftershock and 2 Mystic Shots as interaction, and not really a curve at all. If you look at that, just 1 1-drop and 1 2-drop and a ton of 3-drops. They understand what I'm talking about. And some late game. I'm very surprised that this deck went that far. I guess just if people don't remove your Heimerdinger, you get infinite value and you're still Targon. But definitely my respect for getting this far, but it was just a good matchup for us since we could shut down Heimerdinger Zoe pretty easily and all these other engine cards. This was with our own deck, and I'm quite happy with how it turned out in the end. Oops, that was the wrong deck, I'm sorry. Again, it still doesn't show up in this expedition tab where I could show you more of these. But if you look at this deck, Misfortune was great, just pulling in units. We saw it in the last game with our challengers. Renekton won us multiple games, just such a good beat stick and overwhelm unit to close out the games if you can manipulate the combat and don't run into vengeances. Charvan 4, obviously insane, just coming in without play, spending an action and just killing your opponent's unit is so strong. Tracker was nice, Box the Post basically the same role. Hayat Gun was also a strong 2-drop. We had some synergies with the Honored Lords. Rockhopper is sadly not showing up, but Rockhopper is obviously one of the strongest cards in this archetype. We had some Merciless Hunters, Prodigy, more Challenger units, quite strong. Sergeant came in clutch for our opponent once, but also a pretty solid unit. And I liked the Safecracker actually, it had like more of a filler role, but it was decent. And all these middle game units, I didn't think we draw it through them quite often. Runerunner was great with Siphoning Strike that one game. We didn't draw Genevieve, and Cithria was just like this late game top deck, and she would have won the game if it wasn't for our opponent to win first. Exhaust was decent, we could have used it as like stopping the opponent's combat as well. Absolver didn't really draw that. Aegis didn't draw that, but probably would have been fine. Rite of Judgment killed important units. Riposte was a decent combat trick back to back as well. And I really like the Siphoning Strikes. Like, if you want to go for this Challenger archetype, prioritize A, Rockhoppers, B, Siphoning Strikes, and C, a good curve and good units. And of course, the Screeching Dragons if you find some. So that's going to be it for this run. Check out our Discord and ask any questions and about gameplay or about drafting, and I will answer everything. Hope you learned something, and I'll see you next Monday or Friday for another Legends of Runeterra video. Bye!